Thanks for joining us for Ruth Institute's podcast. Our website is www.ruthinstitute.org. We seek to change the narrative around marriage and family to create a cultural climate favorable to lifelong married love. We also seek to promote recovery and healing from the wounds of the sexual revolution and share our stories with the next generation. I encourage you to visit our website, where you can sign up for our free e-newsletter and receive more information on what we're doing around the country and how you can be involved. Dr. J is a guest on Phyllis Schlafly's Equals, where she discussed the sexual revolution's attack on the family with interviewer Sherilyn Eager.
Welcome back. It's Sherilyn Bacon Eager with Ed Martin, and this is the Phyllis Schlafly Eagles Radio Live. We are delighted this remainder of the show today to be with Jennifer Roback Morse. Dr. Morse is the founder of the Ruth Institute, a global nonprofit organization focused on keeping the family together, protecting the rights of children, helping millions of people who have been harmed by the family breakdown. She has authored and co-authored four books spoken around the globe on marriage, family, and human sexuality. Her work has been translated into Spanish, Chinese, Korean, Polish, and her newest book is The Sexual Revolution and Its Victims. Dr. J, welcome.
Thanks for having me on, Sherilyn.
You have been very impactful with so many people and their lives, and this is what you're calling the sexual revolution. Now, we talk about that frequently on this show. Tell us what that means, and how did you get engaged at the level that you are at this moment in time?
Well, I'll tell you, I define the sexual revolution as having three main components. The first component is that a good and decent society should do everything it can to separate sex from babies, okay? And I call that the contraceptive ideology. And the second point is that a good and decent society should do everything it can to separate both sex and babies from marriage. And I call that the divorce ideology. And then finally, a good and decent society should do everything it can to break down all differences between men and women, except any differences that people might explicitly choose to bring upon themselves, such as the transgender movement. And I refer to that as the gender ideology. And so the sexual revolution, in my mind, consists of those three interlocking ideologies. And what you'll notice, if you listen closely, is that all three of those things are false. You know, it's just not true. It's not possible to build a whole society around the idea that sex is sterile. You know, sex actually does make babies. Children actually do need their parents, and that's why you need to be having sex and babies inside marriage. And then finally, men and women really truly are different. And so what we have are a group of people with a lot of power and a lot of money in our society who are doing everything they can to create a world that cannot exist, that is irrational and impossible, and therefore they need a lot of power, they need a lot of money, they need a lot of force to try to bring that into being. And that's why the sexual revolution is a totalitarian ideology. It has been from the beginning, in spite of what it's ever said about itself being about liberation. It's been a totalitarian ideology from the beginning, and I think that's becoming more and more clear.
Dr. J, on your website, theruthinstitute.org, you have a list of, I believe it's 12 different ways that people have been affected by this sexual revolution. Can you enumerate some of those, at least in the time that we have?
Yes. We call them the survivors of the sexual revolution. And of course, some people haven't really survived the sexual revolution. Some people have actually died from it in various ways. But right at the top of the list, Sherilyn, is children of divorce. Children of divorce are the number one victim of the sexual revolution, because people have been saying all along, kids are resilient. Adults can do whatever they want and the kids will be fine. As long as the parents are happy, the children will be fine. And this is simply not true. And we know this now from social science, and we know it from individuals telling us about it, you know, if they're ever allowed to have the chance to talk. So the children of adults, the children of divorce, many of whom are now adults, of course, are survivors and victims of the sexual revolution. and children of single parents or unmarried parents, the reluctantly divorced persons. Reluctantly divorced persons, that's a term that I invented, and I know this is something Phyllis Schlafly was well aware of and very tuned into, and that's the case where somebody would like to stay married, and they've done nothing wrong, but because of no-fault divorce, the government will take sides with the person who wants the marriage the least. And so a perfectly blameless individual can be separated from their home, their family, and their children for having committed no crime at all. And so that's the reluctantly divorced. And then there are post-abortive women, pornography addicts, refugees from the hookup culture, that is people who have participated in the hookup culture and have figured out that it's an empty promise and they would like to live some other way. People cohabited and regretted it. Did I mention the post-abortive woman? And also the heartbroken career woman, the woman who has a great career, great education, but she waited so long to begin her family that she's now unable to have the children that she would like to have. I consider that person to be also a survivor of the sexual revolution. So, you know, there are many more categories and much more I could say about each one, but I think that gives people a flavor of the idea that trying to separate sex from babies doesn't really, in the end, make people happy. And trying to separate children from their parents certainly doesn't make people happy. And pretending that men and women are exactly the same, that's a recipe for ending up as a heartbroken career woman. Because men can have babies pretty much any time, and women really can't, you know. Mm. So we have to have some provision for differences between men and women for the benefit of women. And, of course, that's been completely obscured by the sexual revolution. So that's an example. Those are some examples of the ways in which people have been harmed.
Well, Dr. Morse, this is Jennifer Roback Morse we're speaking with. She's with RuthInstitute.org. If you go to this website, you have a quiz there. This is amazing, Dr. J, because I don't know many people who have not encountered, at least maybe not in their immediate family, but within their extended family, some of these very, very emotional responses. And the questions that you have a quiz, I think are extremely helpful to those that are struggling. This lie that we have all been told that, yes, we just have to take care of ourselves, our children will adapt, that has created, I think, at least two or three generations of children who are now adults who have been raised in an environment where they have struggled with the feelings of abandonment and separation anxiety. How do we overcome two or three generations of people that are now trying to pull their own families together and be responsible parents? And what are we seeing culturally happening as a result of this breakdown?
Well, you've asked several very big questions.
I know. Go for it. I know that you can handle every single one of them.
Well, let's take them one at a time. I mean,
yeah.
In 2001, I wrote my first book that was called Love and Economics. And the theme of Love and Economics is that civilization depends on children having a good first year. And what I mean by that is that children need to attach to their parents. They need to feel safe. They need to feel like they belong. This is the foundation for people developing a conscience and for developing a secure sense of themselves and who they are and their identity. And if you don't have that, young people are going to enter into adulthood deprived and damaged in various ways. They may not even recognize that it's the case. But it's not unusual for kids to have anxiety and depression and those types of issues. And so what I ask myself in Love and Economics is, what's going to happen if children are raised without good attachments to their parents and without that sense of strong foundation of being loved and belonging? What's going to happen when those kids grow up?
I think we're seeing it in our college students today, and the way they respond to not even being able to handle somebody that disagrees with them, maybe on a public policy issue. Even To me, I think that especially with young men and in a demographic, African American demographic, where 70+ percent of them are being raised by single mothers, I think we're seeing the results of that, don't you?
Well, yes, and what a lot of young people need is a sense of belonging, and so if they're poverty-stricken, they'll find a sense of belonging in a gang. Mm-hmm. Or in casual sexual encounters. If they're in college, they may find a sense of belonging by attaching themselves to an ideology, you know, where they feel like, I'm part of this tribe, I'm part of this team, and all I have to do is continually pledge my allegiance to these set of mm-hmm. ideas and everything will be fine, you know. So I do think that people are less and less able to kind of meet life's challenges on life's own terms. You see it particularly in people's ability to form stable marriages and relationships and take care of their own kids, mm-hmm. you know. And I hear this all the time. I hear this all the time from people individually, you know. Mm-hmm. You know, forget about stuff that's in the news. Just think about people you talk to and people you meet. You know, I'll meet people in their 30s who are, you know, who are married and have a few small children mm-hmm. and stuff. And they'll say to me, you know, my parents were divorced and I'm not really sure how this is going to work. I mean, I want it to work. I want to stay married, but mm-hmm. I'm not sure how to make it work, you know?
Yeah.
And my heart breaks for them. And so that's why we've developed some of the programs we've developed, you know, to try to address some of this stuff. Because the one thing we know is that trauma, that especially childhood trauma, but any trauma that is not addressed just gets worse over time, right? Mm-hmm. And the consequences get worse over time. And we're really, you know, kind of papering over and trying to medicate mm-hmm. a whole lot of things that actually are quite traumatic, and we're not dealing with them head on.
Well, I've come to understand that there's really no good age of a child for parents to consider divorce, and that it even affects the adult children, maybe even more so. But Dr. J, I want to go into the other two areas that you have highlighted, the contraception culture and the transgender culture, and how that is impacting society and families and children. Which one would you like to tackle first?
Well,
and then we want to make sure that we get around to what to do about all of this.
Okay. Well, let's start with the gender ideology, because people will sometimes say to me, you know, Dr. Morse, where did this transgender thing come from all of a sudden? And what I want to say about that is that it didn't just come out of nowhere all of a sudden, because people have been trying to degender everybody for a long time. And this is what Phyllis Schlafly noticed. Phyllis Schlafly, God rest her soul, what I admire so much about her is that she was the first person in her generation to recognize the so-called feminist movement for the totalitarian movement that it really was. Because it was trying to tell women that the way to happiness is for you to act like a man and for you to be like a man. And the proper thing for society to do is to make it possible for women to do everything on the same terms that men do. And in order to do that, of course, we have to distort ourselves. You know, we have to, little girls were not supposed to say, oh, I want to be a mommy when I grow up. Even if she really did want to be a mommy when she grows up, you know. And we treat little boys so that they have to, you know, sit still in school for, in the same way that little girls are supposed to sit still in school. Well, that's ridiculous, you know. And so the degendering of society has been going on for a long time. And what we're seeing with transgenderism is kind of the final step of that. The so-called feminists have been trying to degender everybody for a long time. You know, I used to be able to say that feminism means men and women are identical, except women are better. And that was pretty much the way, you know, kind of old school feminism presented itself, was that men and women are, any differences you see between men and women are all culturally constructed. And so therefore we can reconstruct the culture so that all of those differences go away. And that's what it means to have justice. But now we've gotten to the point where people can reconstruct their own bodies if they don't like what gender they are and what their body really is. And so that's what transgenderism is all about, is that you can physically reconstruct yourself.
And with a false sense that when you physically reconstruct yourself, except they haven't reconstructed the DNA yet, that it's going to solve everything.
That's right. That's exactly right. And so, oddly enough, the the transgender man's idea of what it means to be a woman is the most stereotypical, you know, kind of phony woman that you can imagine, right? I mean, the sort of thing that, that a 1970s feminist would be aghast at, you know, that it, what it means to be a woman is to have well-polished nails and stiletto heels, you know. That's Bruce Jenner's idea of what it means to be a woman. So there are many contradictions that are coming to the fore. What it all amounts to is a revolt against the human body, you know, that people don't like the fact that we're made male and female, that our bodies are male and female, that we're different, but in many respects equal, right? But we're not identical. And so that's what both ends of it, whether it's the feminist end or the transgender end, they're both at war with the reality of the human body and the gendered nature of the human body. And so that's what makes it so so dangerous, really, you know, to be at war with the human body is no small thing.
Well, Dr. Jay, so I think it's there's a sense of humor we have to have in this on just what the feminist movement is going to do about this with men wanting to be women and then competing against them in athletic competitions. That's a problem.
See you know, and this shows that the issue was never really the, whatever issue they said it was. Okay, the issue was always the revolution. The issue was always power. So for years and years, we were told that Title IX of the Civil Rights Act meant that you had to have equal numbers of men's sports and women's sports, even though more men were interested in sports than girls. And the civil rights people went around college campuses and even high schools shutting down men's athletic programs because it was unfair, see? And now you've got boys who think they're girls, barely transitioning to be girls, but just identifying themselves as girls. And now they're competing in track meets and becoming the state champion, the state girls champion. And these are boys who wouldn't get the time of day if they were competing against other boys, right? Mm-hmm. And so, but the transgender people and the new era of political correctness, those boys really are girls, and that's what it means to be a girl, girls, whoever says they're a girl. So it was never really about women having the opportunity to participate in sports because that's good for them and so on. It was really about shutting down men's wrestling programs. Today, it's not really about equality or anything like that. It's really about the government having the power and authority saying, well, this kid says he's a girl, so we're going to say he's a girl, and we're going to enforce that against anybody who shows up, and we have the power to tell you and the school and everybody else that this is this person who's obviously a boy is actually a girl. You know, well, that's an enormous amount of power for the government to have, for them to take on themselves. And so that's how you can really see that it was about power all along. Mm-hmm. You know, it was never about women. It was always about power.
Let's touch on the what you're calling the contraceptive part of this.
The contraceptive ideology. Yes, the contraceptive ideology is that you should be able to act as if you have perfectly functioning contraception. We should build the whole society around the idea that sex is a sterile activity. Well, of course, it's not a sterile activity. And, you know, when people act on that and start having sex with somebody that would be a disaster to get pregnant with, then the person that couple has a couple of choices, and none of them are good choices. You know, abortion, or single parenthood, or adoption. Right, and all of those choices, you know, they're bad, worse, and worst. You know, because they separate the child from having a relationship with both parents. That's completely out of the picture as a priority. Right, and so many of the things that we see are dependent on the belief that contraception is perfect and that you have abortion as a backup plan and that those things are all perfectly safe. No side effects to abortion, no side effects to hormonal contraception. Don't worry about it, just do what you want. You know, you just wouldn't be able to do many other things in the sexual culture would be unthinkable without that assurance, that, you know, that you could have sex without babies. So that's why that's so important. You know, this is not a theological thing I'm saying here.
I remember a slogan back in the days of Stop ERA when I first met Phyllis Schlafly, and it was, you can't fool Mother Nature.
That's right.
And I just see the manipulation of what was put in place as a natural event to happen in our lives, giving birth to babies, has been really distorted, and we're reaping the whirlwind on that in so many levels that you have clearly identified on your website, the Ruth Institute, ruthinstitute.org. You have got to go to this website. It's one of the best put together websites, and there are things that can be done, Dr. J, to help mitigate all of the damage that this culture of feminism has created. Tell us about that.
Well, we've created a number of programs, and the main one I want to talk about is called Healing Family Breakdown Spiritual Workshop. We feel like there are so many people who've been damaged by the sexual revolution who haven't even figured that out, that that's what's caused it. You know, there are a lot of people who are politically unaware, politically disengaged, but their lives have been destroyed by these very bad political ideas and the power that they have achieved within the society, you know. And so I'm thinking here now of children of divorce and people who have cohabited and it turned out badly for them, you know, people whose parents were divorced, people who were abandoned by a spouse, all of the people who've taken contraception and ended up with health problems as a result of it. All of these people have been harmed by the sexual revolution. They've never connected the dots back to what has caused it. And so on two levels, we need to heal that family breakdown, you know. Just as an issue of justice and mercy to the people who've been harmed, they deserve better, you know. they deserve to be told the whole truth. And secondly, as a long-term strategic principle, these are people who, once they figure out that they've been duped and what's been done to them, they're going to be promoters of the natural family, opponents of sex education in schools, opponents of divorce on demand, all of those kinds of things. They're going to be engaged because they know, and you won't be able to talk them out of it. You will not be able to talk them out of it with some kind of slick political campaign, you know, that this was damaging and that it doesn't work and it can't be made to work. So we have we've developed a half-day program that's somewhere between a retreat and a workshop. That we hold at churches. We need to have about 100 people in the audience in order for us to be able to, you know, bring it to a community. And people, it's a combination of me talking, you know, I give little talks, but then people interact at their table with the other people at the table and just try to process what has happened to them. And the net result of it, Sherilyn, is that people come away from that workshop knowing that they were not alone, that you and your family are not the only ones that have had this happen to them. And so it's not a bad reflection on you, or you're a bad person, or your family's all messed up. It's happening to everybody. If it's happening to everybody, you know, we have to be gentle with ourselves, you know. So number one, you're not alone. Number two, it was not all your fault. And if you were the child, of divorce, not your fault at all. You know, you are not a bad child. That's not what made your parents divorce. A lot of times children think that in their innocence, in their magical thinking. They think, if I had just been a better little girl, this wouldn't have happened in our family, you know. But you carry that. If you don't deal with it, you carry that through life. So we want to convey to people it was not your fault. And then finally, we want to say, I say personally to everyone listening, I am so sorry that these things have happened to you. I am sorry this has happened to you. As a member of the baby boom generation, I say to the younger generation, I am sorry for the mess that we have left you. And I apologize, and I'm trying to do my part to make things right. And that's what we teach people to say to one another. If they're dealing with a loved one or family member who is hurting, we teach people, listen to them. Don't just yammer and try to sell them on your ideas. No, just be quiet and give them a chance to talk. Just be sure you tell them, I'm sorry this happened to you, and it wasn't all your fault, and you are never going to be alone again. You are not alone.
Dr. J, that's a divine law to forgive and seek forgiveness.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
All right, how do people get engaged in this? We have just a minute here.
Okay, well, if you go to ruthinstitute.org, right on the opening carousel on the home page, there's a picture of me, and it says Healing Family Breakdown on it. You just click on that, and it will take you to all the information, a page where there's all the information about where we'll be right now. We're coming up on an event in Lake Charles, Louisiana, so I hope people who are listening to you from Texas and Louisiana will look into that and sign up for Healing Family Breakdown in Lake Charles in 2 weeks. And we have retreats scheduled for Phoenix and Kansas City. And you can bring it to your own community. And there's a place there, there's a page there where you can find out how to bring it to your community, too.
That's wonderful. Dr. J, I want to do everything I can personally to help you bring these workshops and retreats to as many places as we can across this country. This has been a delight to visit with you today. There's so much more that we could have gotten into in no time. But I want to wish you the very best in this this cause and the passion that you have and the expertise that you bring to this table. And this is Dr. Jennifer Roback-Morse. Thank you so much for being here with us. RuthInstitute.org. You have a wonderful day.
Thank you so much. Bye-bye.
You've just been listening to our podcast of Dr. J's interview on Phyllis Schlafly's Eagles. She spoke with Sherilyn Eager about the sexual revolution's attack on the family. Our website is www.ruthinstitute.org, and we're also on Facebook. Like the Ruth Institute or Dr. Jennifer Roback-Morse pages for updates. Our podcasts can be found online at ruthinstitute.org and iTunes, and as always, they're under a Creative Commons license. If you've enjoyed them, please share them with friends. The Ruth Institute is a nonprofit educational organization devoted to bringing hope and encouragement for lifelong married love and healing within the family.